Let me just say as I start, my heart is exceptionally heavy regarding all of this. This has been a huge burden. I feel completely inadequate for the task. I am well aware that whatever I say or do, there will be people who are unhappy, and the unhappy people will undoubtedly, to some degree, blame me. And that's what happens in my position, and I guess I just have to suck it up, as they say. Nonetheless, I do feel a real burden to try and get this right. And I know that being the sinful man I am, that is impossible to do so perfectly. And I pray and I ask that you would give me grace in this matter, as in all others. You will have heard this week, most of you, though apart from those of you who are doing social media fasts, which I hear more and more people doing right now, which makes a lot of sense, that the governor of the state has mandated a ban on singing in places of worship as of a couple of days ago. With regards to the very basic practicalities of that, there was a 14-page document that is simply an update of the previous document from the health department, and it says now on page 3 that we must not sing. On page 13, it says that we must seriously consider not singing, and therefore the document in itself seems to be contradictory. I am fairly certain, though I'm no mind reader, that they didn't edit the last part of it as well as they should have done, and the intent is that we must not sing. But nonetheless, the mandate doesn't make that abundantly clear, and therefore some people will simply say that it's unenforceable. And I just present that and leave that with you. I did, as I said earlier in the service, I contacted Burbank Police Department. They will not be enforcing this. There is a code department that is dealing with code enforcements. I think generally, not just the coronavirus ones. And when I was given that number, I got through to a single person on a single desk who was away, and they're not back until after the weekend. But I know that for many, the issue of enforcement is a non-issue, and so I just give you that information as it is. With regards to submission to the state, 1 Peter chapter 2, we dealt with not that long ago as a church. We went through 1 Peter. It was conveniently there for us before the coronavirus. And I am so glad I taught what I did, because I can refer back to it without any corrections or like, oh, I wish I hadn't said that. And what I did say, for those who weren't there or don't want to go back and listen to that sermon, is simply this, that we as Christians, take a step back. We as human beings, and this will be a mini sermon, all of this, and I apologize, but all of this needs to be said. We as human beings are all sinners, and it is in our nature to rebel. And therefore, submission is not something that any of us want to do. And we need to constantly be on our guard against that. But nonetheless, submission to government means submitting ultimately to, as the scripture says, the emperor or king. America makes this very difficult. It's very difficult anyway, because of course there is submission to government, and then there are issues where, you know, if the government says you shall not worship Jesus anymore, then we say, I will fear God and not fear man, and I'm not going to obey that. We all agree on that, hopefully. So there's areas where we don't disagree. Quite where that line is, quite where that point is that we say, well, this is actually would be a contradiction of scripture where I submit to that, is an area that not everybody is going to agree on anyway. When you throw into the mix that this country's highest authority is a constitution and not an individual, so whatever any individual says, the constitution has a higher authority, it then gets even more confusing. I have heard people over the last few months talk about how we do not have to obey this law or this mandate because it's unconstitutional, and others saying, well, you need to submit to those lower authorities and then work its way through until it gets to the top, and you need to submit until it's worked its way through. And others will say, well, the constitution has been unchanged and is unchanged, and therefore the decision has already been made, and what have you. And I hear all of you. And every time someone talks to me about it, I go, yeah, that's a really good point. And then someone says the completely opposite. I go, yeah, that's a really good point. And I am so glad that I am not a political commentator. I am so glad that that is not in my remit, because I don't know the answers to this. I simply don't. And It is a very complicated situation here anyway. And then when we have state governors making mandates that are not by definition law, they've not been passed by Congress, and people are then saying, well, do we have to obey those mandates or do we not? And the whole thing is just a mess. And I know people who I would say they know the Bible better than I do, who are standing on their soapbox and saying, this is an assault on the church, it's discrimination, and we need to stand up and stand against this. And I know others who I know love the Lord just as much and they know their Bible just as well, who are saying, you know what, we just need to submit to the government on this one and not fight it. And the reality is people are going to come to different conclusions. And on top of all of that, were it not enough already, there are other issues that complicate it further. We are commanded to love our neighbors. And therefore, it may well be necessary for those of us who say, well, you know what? I'm not obliged to wear a mask. I don't see the need for me to wear a mask. To wear a mask out of love to those around us. And it may be necessary for other people to show their loves in other ways, allowing for those who don't want to wear a mask. And then on top of that, there is, of course, our views on ecclesiology, the doctrine of the church that plays a huge role in this. I've heard many people quoting from the book of Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 25 about not neglecting to meet together while we were on lockdown. Some people were saying, well, we should never have agreed to a lockdown in the first place. We should have been meeting every single week because we shouldn't neglect to meet together. And others are saying, you know what, we're not neglecting to meet together. We're just simply taking a break for health reasons and loving one another and blah, blah, blah. But I think that if our ecclesiology is based solely on Hebrews 10:25, we have a very shallow ecclesiology. We need to be looking far more at verses like Ephesians 4, where Paul talks about the giving of the gifts and us ministering in the gifts one to another, to being equipped by those with the teaching gifts so that we might do those work of ministry and us ministering one to another. And it talks about in Ephesians, as it goes on through that section into chapter 5, about singing and praising as well. And so some people on the basis of Ephesians 5 are saying, when you start talking about singing, you're now mandating how we worship and you have no place to do that. Oh my goodness, it's a mess. And it's so complicated. So what do we do? Well, firstly, as a church, we have sought very, very hard to accommodate everybody. I am well aware that there are people who believe that the very fact that we insist on people having a mask as they come in the door is in all of itself a compromise. And I know that there are people who would want to be here right now, but because people aren't wearing a mask literally every second they're in the church, even when they're 6 feet apart from other people, that they won't be here. And we cannot please everybody. We simply can't. It's catch 22. Whatever I do, someone's going to be upset. Whatever we do as a church, someone's going to be upset. So what we have sought to do is to try and love everybody as best we can. We have tried to create an environment at church that allows to a degree of flexibility while still keeping to the regulations that were generally imposed upon us. And at the same point, we've set up a live stream so that those who don't feel safe and comfortable to be here can still have our services. And I apologize for the fact that now it's just the sermons, but that's just how it's going to be while this additional mandate is in place. And I do believe, and let me just say this as well, that we as a church, I do believe, have been respectful in this regard. I have seen people reading the room respectfully, consistently, and I'm very, very pleased to see that. If somebody comes up to you for a conversation and they are wearing a mask, you put your darn mask on, because they have indicated to you by wearing a mask how they feel, and we are going to respect them, even if we don't agree. That's how we are. And I see that happening and I applaud you for it. There needs to, I know that broadly speaking, those who are more relaxed feel comfortable to be here. And broadly speaking, those who are less relaxed don't feel comfortable. And that's why we have a live stream. We're trying to serve everybody as best we can. And we're getting a degree of feedback. And I think that mostly we're doing well. But that's all we can seek to do, is to love you and to serve God. So what is our response as a church now with this new mandate? Many other churches have come up with a variety of responses. We often associate ourselves with other local churches who have very similar theologies and very similar practices and what have you. And the two churches that we associate ourselves with most locally are Calvary Bible Church down the road in Burbank and Grace Community Church up in Sun Valley. I have lots of personal links and friendships and what have you with people there. And we as a church certainly feel affiliated to some degree or other, even if it's unofficial. One of those churches has, because of this mandate, closed down all live services, period. The other one has said that that's a line that shouldn't have been crossed and we're going to be singing just as we always would. And they have both made stances that are complete opposites, even though theologically they're almost identical. Which just goes to show you how varied the whole thing is. As for me, well, it doesn't matter. And I really mean that sincerely. I am not someone whose opinion matters. You say, that's ridiculous. You're the pastor. Of course your opinion matters. No, it doesn't. Because I want you to understand this. I am not sitting on the fence. I have opinions. I have opinions on all sorts of things. I have strong opinions on things that really people shouldn't have strong opinions on. You know, how you say Worcestershire and things like that. How we spell saviour. I have very strong opinions on lots of matters. And those of you who follow me on social media probably see far more of them than you should. And on Tuesday nights, we discuss anything you want to do. And my wife constantly rebukes me for the complete lack of filter that I have. And how I'm always saying things I probably shouldn't say. So if you want to catch me off guard, Tuesday night is the night to do it. That said, I want this to be absolutely abundantly clear. I am not sitting on the fence on this issue. I'm not sitting on the fence. Our position as a church is a position. It's not an abstaining. It's not a sitting on the fence. We have a position. So let me tell you our position on the singing mandate, on coronavirus, on all of this. Let me tell you the position that we have taken as a church. We as a church will continue, as we have done, to major on the majors and to minor on the minors. That's our position as a church. We will divide forcefully with those who would engage in false doctrine. We will stand firm on the word of God and we will not waver. But when it comes to minor issues where people of like mind disagree on areas of conscience, then we will submit to Romans 14. We will try and as best we can bear with our weaker brethren, but we will not be making decisions on your behalf. Listen, if you want to know what you should eat to be healthy, I have got so many opinions, but you won't hear it from the pulpit. I won't be telling you what kind of doctors to go to, whether to vaccinate your children, which political person to vote for in each and every election. I will have no input on these kind of extra biblical matters. I will simply teach you the Bible and allow you to live your own lives. Do we want to be the kind of church that is heavy shepherding? One of the things I do think is major is the issue of legalism. And from the very first time I stepped into this church for my interview, I made it abundantly clear. I do not do legalism. And I will resist it, and I will oppose it, and I will stamp it out as much as I would sexual sin or any other sin that would normally be resisted and stamped upon. This is not something that I will compromise on. We will not be a legalistic church. That's our position. And it stands to this day. If you feel differently than me on these issues, fantastic. I'm so happy. And I'm not even saying that as a joke. I am so happy that there are people in this church who hold different views than me. You know why? Because we live in a society right now where everybody is creating their own bubbles. People are deciding, you know what? I'm going to have just this group of friends. Oh, you disagree with me? I'll unfriend you on social media. I won't talk to you anymore. I will simply surround myself with those people who think like I do. And then when somebody else comes along who has a different view, then we can all together in our little bubble just say, oh my goodness, how ridiculous are they? That's the way society's going. And I value my friends who share opinions different than me because it's my job to love them. And how can I love them if I don't listen to them? So I want us I want you to understand that we as a church are not sitting on the fence. We are taking a stand, and our stand should be abundantly clear that we are letting you make decisions according to your own conscience with the encouragement to do so. And hear this, because this is most important of all, that as we all walk according to our consciences, we must love one another. If we agree with someone, then it really isn't hard to love them. If we disagree with someone, then we see the state of our hearts. Paul says in Ephesians 4 that we should walk in a manner that is worthy of the calling. That we should walk with all humility and gentleness, with patience. That we should forbear with one another in love. And we should be eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace. If you think that people should be stricter with regards to coronavirus than they are being, then I want you to treat them with humility and with gentleness. I want you to be patient with them. And I want you to forbear with them in love and do everything that you can to maintain unity with them and peace in this congregation. If you think that people are being too strict with regards to coronavirus, then I want you to walk in a way that shows humility and gentleness to those with whom you disagree, to be patient towards them, to forbear with them in love, and to do everything that you can to maintain the unity and the peace that this church should have. That's my position. That's our position as a church. We believe in unity and peace and love and forbearance and gentleness and humility and all of these things with how we treat one another, particularly when we don't agree. That's our position. So this is what we are going to do every Sunday while the singing mandate is in place. We are going to put words on the screen and we are going to play music that we, as always, might be motivated and challenged by those words to think and dwell upon them, to chew upon them, and to use them as worship in our hearts. Whether individuals choose to stand or sit, whether individuals choose to sing or not to sing, whether individuals choose to sing with a mask on or not, that is up to them. And we will love those with whom we disagree. There are those who want to take this as an opportunity to sow discord and disharmony. Whether it is the coronavirus, the health implications, the issues of submission to state, whether it is the racial tension and conflict that this nation is feeling and all the various responses to that, there are those who want to sow discord amongst this church. I am not taking a stand officially on any of those things. Of course I have opinions. That is not the place of this pulpit to teach you what to believe about these various things. But let it be clear, there should be no discord and disharmony. If any of these various issues and the way that other people in this church are responding to them is causing any bitterness and frustration and anguish and harshness in your heart, then you need to repent of it. I know you're right and they're wrong. That's how it always works, isn't it? We hold the views we hold because we're right. But we will treat those who we believe to be wrong with as much grace as we would want them to treat us. In fact, more so. We will treat them as Christ treats us. I am so thankful. Can you imagine if when you had first gotten saved, Jesus had just printed up for you the first 100 pages of the sins you had to deal with? Grace, my friends, grace. That is what should distinguish us. So, I hope that our position as a church is abundantly clear on this matter. I won't be tolerating those who would want to critique and criticize those who do it differently. Love, my friends, love. And let us do the best we can. Keep reading that room. Keep being respectful. Keep putting your masks on as you come. And when you're getting, you know, within less than 6 feet with people, if you're not sure of their position, we just mustn't want to put anybody in a situation they don't want to be in. But I am not here to enforce government mandates on you. I'm not here to force anything upon you. I'm here to teach you the scripture. And it's a struggle enough to do that at the best of times, friends. So let me stick to that. So I hope that though we may disagree on a vast multitude of things, I hope we can agree on love. I hope we can agree on forbearance. I hope we can agree on humility. And I hope we can agree on peace. Let the enemy be thwarted. Let him not have victory amongst us in this regard. Love, forbear, forgive. Grace to all.